Matthew chapter 9 verse 35. Here the word of the Lord is telling us, and Jesus went about all the cities and villages. Well, if that's all you read, you say, well, everything is done, everything is finished, because Jesus went throughout all the cities and all the villages, teaching in their synagogues and preaching the gospel of the kingdom and healing every sickness and every disease among the people. But look at verse 36. But when he saw the multitudes, he was moved with compassion on them, because they fainted and because they were scattered abroad as sheep having no shepherd. After he had gone through all those cities and all those villages, it was after that he then saw the multitudes, the people that are yet to be reached. And now he said in verse 37, then saith he unto his disciples, the harvest truly is plenteous, but the laborers are what? The few. He was telling them, if you think because I've gone through all those cities and I've gone all through all those villages and then people, every sickness have been healed everywhere he had gone, if you think because of that everything is done, he said the harvest truly is plenteous, but the laborers are few. Pray ye therefore the Lord of the harvest that he will send forth. That means much work still to be done. The unfinished work, unfinished task still to be accomplished. Pray ye therefore that the Lord of the harvest, that he will send forth laborers into his harvest. That leads me to point number two. Point number two, we're talking about readjusted focus on Christ's unfinished work. Readjusted focus. If you know, the time, we have the time of the harvest, and then the fruits arrive, and we need to people that to go and reap them. It's at that time you need to readjust your time, adjust your schedule or schedule, adjust the way you spend your time, adjust the focus you have. Otherwise, that harvest will be wasted. And you know something? Look up here for a moment. When you're expecting a baby in the family, you know what the family does. You have father, you have mother, and a baby is just being born. Now, the way the church normally does, they expect that baby just coming into the church. They expect the baby to adjust, rather than the parents adjusting. But in a normal family, a baby is about to be born. The mother is pregnant and they're counting days. She'll soon deliver. You know what they do? The father begins to adjust, and the mother begins to adjust even before that child is born. And then they begin to, you know, clear some things from over there where the baby will be taken care of. And then they begin to look at their finances. They begin to adjust their finances because a baby is coming. They do not expect that it is the baby that will adjust to fit the regular routine of the family. But it is the family, the parents and the siblings, that will adjust because of that baby. The same thing when we're expecting a church to be planted here and babies to be born there and converts to be raised there and those converts to be disciples there, discipled there. It is the church expecting those converts that will adjust. What kind of understanding will the converts have? What kind of church building will the converts be looking for? What kind of music will the converts be looking for? What will keep them? What will interest them? What will make them know that we care for them? But you know, most churches, they continue the way they have always been. And they expect that when those converts come, when those converts are won, immediately the first day of birth and the first day of conversion, all those babies, they will readjust to match the life and the expectation and the pattern of the parents, of the adults in the church. It doesn't happen that way. That means then, if we're really going to do what the Lord is calling us to do, the things that worked yesterday, maybe they're still working for the adults, working for the members, and working for the disciples, and working for the people who are there. But if we're going to get all those converts, and we're going to retain them, get them and retain them, we must adjust. We readjust our focus. And if we know that people are perishing and that we need to reach them in time, we need to readjust everything that we're doing so that by the grace of God, we're going to reach out to them. I said we're going to reach out to them. We're looking at 1 Kings chapter 20, verse 39, verse 40. 1 Kings chapter 20. 1 Kings chapter 20, verse 39. It says, as a king passed by, He cried unto the king, and he said, thy servant went out into the midst of the battle, and behold, a man turned aside, and brought a man, only one man, a single man, unto me, and said, keep this man, if by any means he be missing, then shall thy life be for his life, or else thou shalt pay a talent of silver. This one was just given a man. You are given a city of 600,000, a city of 1 million people, a city of 3 million people, a city of 20 million people. We have done the survey over here in Lagos, and we discover that the places we call our old districts. One old district is about more than 2 million people. Another old district is also more than 2 million people. Another old district, about three of them, more than 2 million people. Another one, more than 1.5 million. Another one, more than 1 million. We've done the survey over here at the headquarters, and we're expecting that each state will look at the major cities of the state, and each nation will look at the major cities in the nation and see the population. The Lord is saying, this man said, only one man was committed to me, but for us, a city, a locality of 2 million people committed into us, not just one person, but this person that one man was committed into his hand. Look at verse 40. And as thy servant was busy here and there, he was gone, just vanished. I can't find him again. And then I was told, keep this man. And as we're busy here and there, the city that God has committed into our hands, gone. And Jonah never thought that Nineveh would repent like that. In fact, the way he preached, see the way he preached. Yet 40 days and Nineveh shall be what? Shall be overthrown. And yet, even with that kind of message, monotonous message, just the same sentence repeated over and over, yet those people, the Spirit of God touched the heart of the king. Your message will reach the king. And all the cabinet, your message will reach their cabinet. And then all the people, and then they set themselves apart, and they fasted and waited upon the Lord, and they cried unto the Lord. And he said, drop everything you want. The repentance that Jonah did not emphasize, it was the king that took over the message and preached that repentance. And everybody repented, and a whole city, all of them became forgiven and saved, and then they escaped the judgment of God. If that can happen through Jonah, it will happen through you. And you know what? At that time, Jonah did not have any partner. We're talking about, Moses and Aaron, and we're talking about Joshua and Caleb, and we're talking about Paul and Peter, and we're talking about Peter and John, and we're talking about Paul and Barnabas, we're talking about Paul and Silas. In the case of Jonah, Jonah and Jonah alone. No other person. And then Jonah did not have all the choir around, all the singers around, all the usher. They're good when they are there. But what if they are not there? And thank God we even have alternatives now. If the choir is not there, you have the tapes. The GHS from 1 to 250, you can find them in the CD and the MP3. And then you can play it in that new church. And then the choir, all the choir pieces that you have recorded all these years from your local and from your state and everything, you can get it from your state capital. In that state, if you say we're planting this new church and there's no choir yet, no problem. You can just go to your headquarters, at the state capital, and then you can have all those tapes. And when it comes to choir time, just play that to them. Even when you don't have all the workers, you can still do the work of the Lord. Jonah did it. You will do it in Jesus' name. And that means then, as the Lord is saying all this, we need to readjust your mind. If there's no choir, we cannot do anything. If there's no PA system, we cannot do anything. If there's no electricity, we cannot do anything. At the time of Jesus, there was no electricity. At the time of Paul the Apostle, there's no electricity. And yet, they went everywhere and they covered the land. We're going to cover the land. It's just a matter of readjusting your priority, and readjusting your focus, and readjusting your mind and your worldview, and understanding that what you have done is just a kind of a minute, a little drop in the ocean. A lot, myriads of people, multitudes of people that are still waiting. And then look at that verse 40. And as the servant passed, thy servant was busy here and there, he was gone. And the king of Israel said unto him, so shall thy judgment be, thyself has decided it. I pray you will not come to judgment. Let's come to Nehemiah chapter 6. Nehemiah, we're looking at chapter 6. Nehemiah chapter 6. I'm reading there from verse 2. Nehemiah chapter 6. We're looking at verse 2. And see how you need to readjust your mind and your focus and schedule so that you will do what the Lord has called you to do. Nehemiah chapter 6. I'm reading there from verse 2. And Sambalat and Geshem sent unto me, saying, come, let us meet together in some one of the villages in the plain of Ono. But they thought to do me mischief. And I sent messengers unto them, saying, I am doing a great work. Anybody doing a great work here? Where are you? You are doing a great work. All the distractions will push them aside. They'll try to call you, come for this and come for this and come for that. You're doing such a great work, the salvation of souls. Greater than any other thing that you can think about in the world. It says, I'm doing a great work. I cannot come down. Why should the work cease while I leave it and come down to you? Yet they sent unto me four times after they sought, and I answered them after the same manner. Then Sambalat, his servant sent his servant unto me in like manner the first time with an open letter in his hand, wherein was written, it is reported among the heathen, and Geshmo says it, that thou and the Jews seek to rebel, for which cause thou buildest the wall, that thou mayest be their king according to these words. And thou hast also appointed prophets to preach of thee at Jerusalem, saying, there is a king in Judah. Now shall it be reported unto the king according to these words. Come now therefore, and let us take counsel together. Now, he put a big lie, a big slander, put all that together, and he wrote it in a letter. And he didn't seal the letter, an open letter. He said, go and give it to him. This one will frighten him. We're going to report it to the king that you are in conspiracy with some people. You are raising up people so that you can be a big man, a king over them. And then you will say, don't listen to the king anymore. I am the king here. And you are appointing prophets. All these strategies you said you are developing. And you said, disciple a whole nation. You appoint this one here, this one here, this one here. You are appointing them for yourself so that they can be talking about you. Give it to him. Now come, let us talk together about this fact, about this matter that we have discovered. And said, go back and tell him, there's nothing like that. All this is just to stop the work. Look at verse 8. Then I sent unto him, saying, there are no such things done as thou seest, but thou finest them out of thine own heart. And that Nehemiah readjusted his mind, that no matter what they say or what they do, that this work the Lord had committed into his hand, he was going to finish it. You are going to finish it. The unfinished task and the unfinished work of Christ that the Lord has now called us to. And let's look at chapter 6, verses 10 and 11. As this same chapter, after what? I came unto the house of Shemaiah, the son of Deliah, the son of Mehetabel, who was shut up. And he said, let us meet together in the house of God. This one is going to be in the house of God now. We're going to meet together there within the temple, and let us shut the doors of the temple. For they will come and slay thee. They'll come and kill you. Yea, in the night they will come to kill you. That is, if you are heady and stubborn, and then you are willful and say, I'm going to do it, I'm going to do it. Because of this new assignment and this new approach, the whole nation, they're coming to kill you. We have secret information. In fact, the letters are passing around. They have built the strategy and they have finalized everything. And they will come upon you suddenly when you are up and doing, and when you say, we're getting the land, we're going here, we're going here, we're going there. Is there somebody will write something and then to threaten you and to frighten you, to make you say, go and hide yourself. Go somewhere. Don't let anybody see you, because they mark you down as number one. They are targeting you. If they see you on the street, on any crusade, you are gone. I am still here. I said, I am still here. You'll still be there for the work of the Lord in Jesus' name. I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. The Lord says, I'm present with you all the time. Look at verse 11. And I said, should such a man as I flee? And which, who is there that being as I am would go into the temple to save his life? I will not go in. You will do the work of God. And that's what the Lord is telling us, that there's something to do. You adjust your focus, you adjust your mind, you adjust your worldview so that it will be done. Point number three now, resources for finishing Christ's unfinished work. Resources for finishing Christ's unfinished work. We're looking at 1 Kings chapter 19. And I'm reading there from verse 15. I was reading about Elijah now. This is Elijah who had destroyed some of the false prophets of Baal. This is Elijah who, after he has brought fire down from heaven, he became afraid because Jezebel said, I hear, he gave me information, this is what you have done, I'm going to be after you. And by this time tomorrow, if I am Jezebel, I'm the queen in this land, what you've done to those prophets of Baal, I'm going to do something. That man became afraid. You will not be afraid. I said you will not be afraid. I'm looking at chapter 19 of 1 Kings and verse 15. And the Lord said unto him, go, return on thy way to the wilderness of Damascus, and when thou comest, anoint Azael to be king over Syria, and Jehu the son of Nimshi shall thou anoint to be king over Israel, and Elisha the son of Shaphat of Abel-Meholah shall thou anoint to be prophet in thy room. And it shall come to pass that him that escapeth the sword of